Hello, hello, everyone. Welcome to CMC Sessions. I see Lisa.
It's like round for room. Every day is round for room now.
Hi, everyone. So really quick, I just wanted to, it looks like everyone's on mute already, but we just like to keep everyone on mute so there's no confusion with sounds going on. But welcome. I would like to first start with just to inform you guys that this is going to be recorded. So if you do not want to be recorded, you can go ahead and turn your video off and that'll be totally okay. Secondly, Community Music Center wishes to respectfully acknowledge that our organization sits on the unceded ancestral homeland of the Ramaytush Ohlone peoples, who are the original inhabitants of the San Francisco Peninsula and who are still living here today. We make this acknowledgement to create greater public consciousness of Native sovereignty and cultural rights as a step towards equitable relationships and reconciliation. So my name is Chantel Hernandez, and I am the Community Music Center Program Coordinator. And I want to thank Trevor Otten, CMC Cultural Traditions Department Faculty Chair, for his coordination of the artist workshop in this series. For those who may be new to the Community Music Center, we are a community music school that offers music classes in many instruments and musical styles. CMC's music classes are all currently online and are offered within a lens of accessibility, offering tuition assistance and sliding scale tuition based on family income. If you have any questions at all during today's presentation, go ahead and enter them in the chat. If you guys want to just talk to each other, that chat is there for you guys to use. And we'll keep track of the questions. And at the end of the presentation, Charlie will, you know, answer everyone to his best ability. Now I would like to welcome Trevor Otten, a faculty member at CMC who teaches violin in his own private lessons in Mission District's Young Musicians Program and also with the SFUSD Mariachi Program. Trevor will now share with you an overview of the series and introduce our artists. Thank you guys.
How's it going, everybody? Thank you so much for showing up. It's great to see so many people here. The series has been, the attendance, I've been so happy about it. And one of the reasons that we put this series together, I do chair the cultural traditions department in the center. So I got a grant through Community Music Center called a partnership grant. They have great grants for faculty to, you know, improve ourselves if we need some gear, if we want to put on presentations like this and other things. So there's resources for teachers that are made possible by the Music Center. And I want to thank Sylvia and Chantel for setting all this up. But the reason that we're doing this is just to show how great our faculty are, and to share their knowledge with whoever wants to come and check it out. And Charlie Gurke is someone that I've been working with for a while at the Mission District Young Musicians Program. It's a long acronym, took me about a year. I had to work there for a year because before I could remember MDYMP. But Charlie's been doing a great job. We work with kids every Saturday morning from 10 to 12. And we play music from Mexico, from Cuba, from Colombia, Dominican Republic, and a lot of different things. We got about, I don't know, a bunch of kids, almost 30. It's probably not 30 right now. And the program's going great. And it's been such an honor and a pleasure for me to work with Charlie. And Charlie's got some stripes. I was asking him today, it's like, oh, what have you been doing with Clave? You're talking about Clave here. That's great, because it's important to me. I run a couple Cuban music classes also at the center. And then I found out, I didn't even know, he's been playing with John Santos a Gargambon electric squeeze box. And, you know, he's got some real clave stripes, we could call him that. So I'm really looking forward to hear what Charlie has to say about all this. And I want to be quick, but I did want to give you some props, Charlie. But I really want to hear what you got to say. So we can talk later. So we're going to go about like what, Charlie, we're going to go about 40, 45 minutes or something. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to have a question and answer session afterwards.
Yeah.
Sounds good. So I think I'm going to pass it off to you now, Charlie.
Awesome. Thanks, Shager. So feel free as we're going along, if you have questions as we go, to type them in the chat, and then we'll also have a Q&A at the end of the session. And so if you type questions in the chat, I'll try to get to them as we go, but if not, you know, I'll go back and try to address as many as possible. Or feel free to wait till the end, you know, if you want to jot them down and bring them up later. Today we're talking about clave, and in particular improvising in clave. I'm going to start out with just a little bit of an introduction to the concept. I imagine some people have an idea of what clave is, or, you know, you've been introduced to it, or, you know, maybe you've been playing, you know, Afro-Cuban music a little bit or a lot bit or any of those things. But we could stay here all night talking about clave. So I'm just going to give a little brief introduction, then we'll get to the kind of the improvisation vocabulary part. So clave is a rhythmic cell or a rhythm. It's also an instrument, but we're kind of talking about it as the rhythm. And it looks like, where is it? This. Is everybody seeing the clave on there? It looks like this, and it sounds like this. I'm going to put a metronome on. I'll put my metronome on a half note, because we really, I'll get into this a little bit more, but we feel the pulse. We write it, in this country anyway, we write it in 4-4, in quarter notes and eighth notes, but we feel the pulse like a half note, like a two feel. So it sounds like this. That's son clave. Rumba clave, notice there's one slight difference, and that sounds like this. So that's the kind of, you know, again, like on the page, that's what it looks like. But what is it? Like, what, you know, what's clave doing? And, you know, how does it work, and how do you play in clave? So clave, and the translation clave is key, but it's not like a key that you put in your door. It's like it's like a key, the way I hear a lot of people translate it is like the key on a map, you know, or like almost like a code, you know, so it tells you how to interpret something. And so clave, when it comes to music, it's telling us how to rhythmically interpret a piece of music. The clave is the rhythmic structure that everything in, you know, whatever piece of music we're playing hangs on. So everything everybody's playing, whether it's, you know, the bass part or a percussion part or your improvisation, is all being structured around that, this rhythm, the clave rhythm. The rhythm itself as this kind of two-part cell, which is obvious when we read it again in 4-4 like this, because each bar represents what we call a side of the clave. So the way I've written them down here, the three side comes first, right? There's three hits in the first bar. The two side is the second bar, where we've got two hits. So we've got a two side and a three side. And what the clave kind of does for us is it sets up this system of tension and release. Like the three side is a little more syncopated, and the two side's a little more straight, a little more downbeat oriented. So there's also more happening on the three side and a little bit less happening on the two side. They're, you know, uneven in terms of the number of hits. And so all the other patterns, all the other instrument patterns, melodies and things that kind of fit onto the clave interact with that that rhythmic tension and release, and it gives it that, you know, this forward motion and this particular rhythmic identity. Now to play in clave is it's a little bit of an elusive concept, and if anybody's been around like Afro-Cuban musicians or clave-based music, you might have heard people talking about something being in clave or out of clave or crossed with the clave, which is a bad. You don't want to cross clave. So what that does is it creates this kind of rhythmic dissonance that you don't want. You want a little bit of tension and you want a little bit of release, but you don't want that. You don't want it to be crossed for it to feel kind of unhinged a little bit. So to play in clave, whether again you're playing a part or you're improvising or you're, you know, a melody or whatever, is to play something that that goes with, in one way or another, this two side, three side kind of back and forth. What gets tricky about that, and what complicates this, is it's all about context. So there's not necessarily anything that is inherently three side or inherently two side. So to be, for instance, like when somebody says something's crossed, it's like you've taken a phrase that fits on the two side and put it on the three side, and a phrase that fits on the three side and put it on the two side, so that the whatever you're playing is against the grain of the clave. But like I said, it's not quite as simple as like we can't make a list of things that here, these things fit on the two side and these things fit on the three side, and then you can just mix and match and you're good to go. And what one really obvious example of that is what's right here on the lower on the page here is we've got two really typical instrument patterns that line up with, in this case, the clave is written in the other direction, and we can talk a little bit about that, but just some tunes or some phrases feel like they start on the two side is the beginning of the phrase, and some start on the three side as the beginning of the phrase or the tune. So I've written it as the phrase starting on the two side. So here's the clave on top. Middle line is the cascara pattern, which is what the timbale player plays on the shell. Cascara means shell, on the shell of the timbales. This is a really typical cascara pattern that you would hear in son and salsa and, you know, lots of Afro-Cuban music. This cascara pattern lines up right with the clave. So here's the pattern. Here's the cascara pattern. By the way, I know we can't hear each other, but feel free to clap along or tap along with me as I do these examples. So I'll count us in here. Let's get our, let's slow it down a little bit. Here we go. Here's the cascara pattern. One, two, one, two, three. Ad infinitum until they change to a bell or something. So that cascara pattern fits on the two side. So now I'll sing the cascara pattern and clap clave. Here's clave starting again on the two side as it's written here. One, two, one, two, three, four. Here's the cascara singing. Da 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 da. It's the reason we don't sing cascara. So it falls. You can kind of feel and hear how it falls right with the two side. On the bottom line here is a really common typical rhythm for the for a piano tumbao or montuno, but that would fits in all kinds of different harmonic contexts, but you hear it all the time. So like over one chord, we might hear this rhythm and it might be voiced something like. To hear that against the clave, here's our son clave again, 2-3 son clave, 2-1-2-3 and Here's the tumbao. Bum ba dum bum 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 ba dum bum 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 ba dum bum bum, and so on again. Ad infinitum. So what I always find interesting when investigating this kind of stuff is notice that the cascata pattern on the three side is the same as the piano tumbao on the two side. 1-2 and of three, and of four. 1-2 and it's the exact same rhythmic figure. So the what makes one of these patterns fit on the two side and or one and the other fit on the three side is again it's not just like, you know, this belongs on the two side and this belongs on the three side, but it's the context. So when we look at the cascata pattern here, the cascata pattern is more downbeat oriented. It's and it has a little less syncopation in the first bar and a little more in the second bar. In addition to lining up with the clave in some places. And when we look at this piano tumbao, it's a little more downbeat oriented, a little more on the beat in the first bar, and a little more syncopated, all upbeat. In fact, all upbeats in the second bar. And so when you put those together, what you get is the cascara. You get that kind of tension and release. In this case, the tension, it's release and tension. The more syncopated side is the second side. And so it's how those two sides work together. It's never just one or the other. And so you find this all the time where you find certain rhythmic patterns, melodic gestures that can work on different sides of the clave, on both sides of the clave, but a lot of it really depends more on the context, you know, what happened on the other side or what's going to happen on the other side when we get there. And so it's a really, it can get really kind of complicated and, you know, like there's a lot to sort of think about, but it's better not to think about it so much, better to listen, try to feel it, check it out, do what we're doing. So I want to look and listen to some examples before we get too deep into a discussion of what clave is. I will say that in terms of learning about this music and this like clave-based music, there are a lot of great resources out there, and including you know, a lot of great teachers and classes here in the Bay Area at the Community Music Center, especially. And when I was learning about this music, something that really helped was Rebecca Melian's Salsa Guidebook, which is a great, just lays out a lot of the really basic instrument patterns for all the instruments, how they relate to clave, and more. You know, there are other things in the book. It has a great discography of things to listen to. And so if you're new to this music, new to these concepts, I would recommend checking that out. It's a great, you know, great resource. And again, it goes over all the different instruments in an ensemble. So no matter what instrument you play, you're able to get a sense of what's going on around you and what you're, you know, what you're listening to as you play and listen. Okay. Um So I'm going to save some of your questions. Thanks everybody for dropping these in the chat. I'm going to save some of them for the end, but Isabel has a great question, which is, what is the background or origin of clave, which I should have led with, really, which is clave really comes from the West Africa. So clave, as I'm going to talk about it tonight, really is going to be in reference to a really kind of specific kind of Afro-Cuban music, or music that's based on Afro-Cuban rhythms. But we find clave in all parts of the African diaspora. So, you know, all any kind of Afro-American, Afro-Latin music has elements of clave in it. Sometimes it's more, or in Afro-Cuban music, it's a little more, what we might say, it's more strict, or it's just more at the forefront. You know, they really kind of made an art out of this kind of rhythmic structure. But it really all comes from West African music that was brought here through the slave trade, and which is why you find it, you know, you find this kind of relationship, this rhythmic tension and release present in all kinds of music, from, you know, jazz and R&B to Cuban music to Puerto Rican music, Colombian music, Brazilian music. It's all over the place in more or less explicit ways. But yeah, it's a great question. I see Traeger put a paragraph in there about it.
Yeah, sorry. I hope you don't mind. I don't want to step on your feet, but.
No, that's great. Yeah.
I'm just going to give a couple little. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. And it's, again, it's, you know, we could take a whole semester, you know, talking about this stuff, because there's so much, you know, so much to dig into. And it has a super long tradition. You know, a lot of the music we're about to dig into right now, the excerpts are all, you know, from the 20th century, kind of from, you know, mid-century and, you know, to the present, sort of. But this, a lot of these concepts and these rhythms have a really unbroken lineage that goes back centuries, you know, even if we're just talking about Afro-Cuban music, you know, so there's a really rich tradition there. Okay, so playing, improvising in clave. So now, you know, let's say you've learned your part, you know, you've been doing some listening, you've learned some tunes, or you're playing in an ensemble, and you're gonna take a solo, and you want to solo in the style, you know, which means soloing in clave, you know, that your rhythmic vocabulary has something to do with the clave and, you know, that rhythmic structure. So what I'm going to share with you, and what I've done a little bit of, is through learning pieces and solos of a bunch of different instruments and a bunch of different recordings, outlined a few things to think about and listen for, and maybe to practice too, when you're working on playing in this style, playing in clave. One thing is to look for those phrases that fit in clave, like those two phrases from the, you know, the cascada pattern or the piano pattern. There were, you know, a two-bar phrase that had that kind of tension and release, you know, and that lined up with the clave. There's also, as I was, you know, mentioning with the metronome, we hear this and feel this music, and if you dance to this music, you shift your weight on the half note to the, you know, this kind of two pulse. So, you know, if you were to dance, you know, we're feeling it in two, which is a big something to always be, to try to anchor yourself in. And when you're soloing, you can lock into that pulse. It's like never a bad idea to just lock into that solid half note pulse. And we hear that a lot in a lot of phrases. You know, people will lay right into that in one way or another. On the flip side of that, there's a really prevalent use of upbeats of eighth note offbeats in this kind of music, in all the instrumental parts, and also in the phrasing, you know, the melodic phrasing and improvisational phrasing, which is a little bit trickier. It's more syncopated, but that's something that we hear all the time, just phrases built from upbeats. So if you were thinking 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and just constant, I mean, maybe not constant, but many upbeats in a row. So what do we got? We got downbeats, we got upbeats, we got clave. We'll do a little bit of listening and checking out some of these transcriptions and look at some of the examples of some of these things and probably a few more things too. So I want to start with this kind of fun live recording of Celia Cruz and Tito Puente. And they are trading a little bit. You'll hear Celia is setting up Tito. Tito Puente is a timbale player. I kind of take for granted most of us probably know who that is, but he's because he's probably, you know, the most famous timbalero in this music or in history. But he's playing the timbales and Celia's singing, but she's imitating, in this case, she's imitating a drum. So they're doing this kind of call and response where she's before she sets him off on his solo here. So let's I'll play this excerpt and follow along. She cuts Tito loose and he takes, you know, a long extended solo. So there are a few things. One thing that I forgot to mention, so we've got like thinking about these different categories of rhythmic phrases that I've outlined here. There's like clave based phrases. There's phrases that emphasize the downbeats, phrases that emphasize the upbeats. And then hemiola or cross rhythm is another ubiquitous kind of rhythmic gesture that we hear all the time. So I'll dig into that in a second because there's a great example of it right here. We'll go back to the top and we'll listen to, I'll play this again. And by the way, I think I can share these PDFs in the chat. So if people want to take them home, you can take them home at the end of the night. If I forget, somebody remind me to do that. I'll play it again so we can read through it again. And it's the first line the top line is always the clave. And then the first system here is Celia singing. And then the second system is Tito responding onto the drum. So as we read through it to help follow along. So this first phrase, there's a lot of stuff that lines up right with the clave. Ba, 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 da, ba, da, da. Da 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 da, ba ba ga da 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 da, ra ga da ga da da, and so you get the like beginnings and ends and, you know, middles of phrases in not always, it's not going to line up with every hit of the clave, but in certain points, especially at the ends of the phrases, you know, at the ends of these phrases where we get ba da, ra ga da ga da da, where the end of the phrase like lines up right with that last beat of the three side. This is another really common thing to listen for. So hemiola, which is the sort of like academic term, we also use, you hear the term cross rhythm or sometimes polyrhythm or these different phrases to describe what in this case is a phrase of three beats but it's taking place in a 4-4 time signature. So if we look here, it's a really great example because it's very clear. We get 1 and 2 and 3. 1 and 2 and 3. And that's our 3-beat phrase, but she just repeats it over and over. So the first one starts right on the downbeat, 1 and 2 and 3. And then the next one starts right here on 4. 4 and 1 and 2, 3 and 4 and 1. And so you get this kind of loop that lines up in different places respective to the downbeat. And then of course it's lining up in different places in respect to the clave too. So you get this thing that again is really common, happens all the time, and it creates another level of rhythmic tension. Because when you play a 3-beat phrase in a 4-4 time signature, one of the things you're doing right there is you're creating more rhythmic tension, because we're feeling, you know, this pulse, but then we're hearing a phrase that's 1 and 2 and 3, 1 and 2 and 3, 1 and 2 and 3, 1, you know, so it's not lining up with that half note. So it's a really cool effect that, again, you hear it, it's prevalent, not just in Afro-Cuban music, but in, you know, jazz and North American music and, you know, Latin music all over Latin America. So, fun thing to play with. So that's, yeah, the hemiola, and it'll show up in a few more examples that we look at too. Well, here's another one, similar, or same device, but a different phrase. Ba 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 da 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 da. So it's again, it's a 3-beat phrase. Da 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 da. 1 and da 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 da. But it's in 4-4. And then we get some nice phrases where she's really laying into these downbeats, or what I've written here as like the half note pulse. Ra-ka-da, just right. Is right there on the downbeat, and then they end with another, you know, really typical kind of phrase, picon 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 picon, with pickups into the downbeat, but a really nice solid kind of downbeat. So just in this short exchange here, we get all these different kind of rhythmic elements, and what's nice about this example is that each phrase kind of demonstrates a different one. You know, they kind of stick to one element or another. What you'll find is in a lot of solos, people move freely between all these different things. You might get a few bars of a cross rhythm, and then a few bars of upbeats, and then, you know, they kind of move back and forth. You know, and these things you can really kind of mix and match, have a lot of fun with. So let's listen to this one more time, and follow along, and then jump to another example. I got a bunch. We probably won't get through all of them. That's okay. Chat, see if there's any specific questions, and I'll go back again and check in. So we'll just keep going. I'll just keep going down my list. Like I said, there's a lot of stuff to check out. Here's a short example from the Buena Vista Social Club. So this is from El Cuarto de Tula, which is a tune, if anybody's been to a salsa club or played in a salsa band, this is one of the more ubiquitous tunes that you'll see in here. And so this is just a short phrase by the trumpet player. Here we go. Manuel Guajiro Mirabal. And this is one of these phrases in between coros. So, you know, a typical device is the coro pregón, which is the pregón is when the singer's improvising. But in son and salsa and a lot of this music, you'll have the coro and then an instrumental solo. And there'll be this call and response. So this is just one response. So we'll hear the coro and then this short trumpet solo here. Right on. So that's it. And I'll play it again. And this, more than anything else for me, this really demonstrates a super typical rhythmic motive that you hear all the time, which is where the phrase starts here with the one measure motive, or really the two beat motive. It's not even a measure, but it's every two beats, which is this rest on the downbeat and then three eighth notes. And so you hear that employed by all kinds of, you know, singers, trumpet players, percussionists, you know, just all kinds of instrumentalists improvising in this music. It's a really, I would say, you know, it emphasizes the upbeats, but it's not just upbeats, you know, so you get a little bit more movement in there. But it's another thing to listen for, and you'll find that it shows up all over the place. It shows up in arrangements. You know, people write, you know, melodies and arrangements that use this kind of phrase. And this brings to mind, like, as we're going through with this kind of stuff, that you can, with any of these ideas, you can figure out ways to incorporate them into your practicing. So one thing is, like, to get this kind of vocabulary into your playing is obviously listen. That's, you know, one of the most important things. Play along and transcribe. So, you know, play along with whatever, you know, stuff you're attracted to, whatever soloists and, you know, songs and stuff you're attracted to. You can analyze it like we're doing now. And then also, you know, if you notice something like this kind of rhythmic phrase that gets used so often, you know, figure out a way to work it into your practicing. You know, you could just take this, you know, just start here. Okay, so that's like a little three note thing, and maybe I'll move that around a scale or something like that. But of course you want to do it with like a metronome, and so you can feel it in time. Two. One, two, three, four. Or whatever. I mean, there's so many ways, you know, to that you could, you know, you do it with arpeggios, scales, chords, you know, etc. But that can be a kind of a fun way to vary your practice routine a little bit, you know, if you're trying to get some rhythmic vocabulary under your fingers and into your head. Take some things that you might be practicing anyway and incorporate these kind of these rhythms, you know, like that kind of like the idea of a hemiola or cross rhythm is another thing, you know. Instead of practicing your scales and arpeggios and just straight eighth notes or quarter notes or whatever, figure out a way to set up that kind of cross rhythm, you know, and it'll help get it, like, help it sink in, you know, because before it comes out when you're improvising, before it comes out of your playing, You need to get it in all these different ways: listening, transcribing, practicing, all that good stuff. Cool. So yeah, I want to make sure we listen to some more. Let's listen to that again because it's short, just to kind of see where we're at. Cherry pick what we're doing here. I got a few pregones from Ruben Blades. Oh, this is a good one. This Ruben Gonzalez. So this is just an excerpt from a solo. This is another recording that came out of that whole Buena Vista Social Club thing. The piano player Ruben Gonzalez did his own recording. This is from the tune Cumbanchero, and I love this example because he just moves between one idea, this hemiola, this cross rhythm, this kind of three over four cross rhythm, to just using upbeats for a phrase, and then comes back to a hemiola for another phrase, and all the while really melodically or note-wise just using a couple simple things, a pedal and a chromatic scale. So it's a really great kind of example of economy of means in a lot of ways, getting a lot out of a little. So let's see, where's that recording? There we go. Listen to that again, but you can really, especially at that tempo, you can really hear how those cross rhythms, those hemiolas, really build a lot of tension. And it adds to that he's using a chromatic scale, which is going to, provide a lot of harmonic tension, harmonic and melodic tension as well. So let me find where that starts. By the way, that's just the top line that he's doing more, more stuff. He's using both hands and whatnot, but just the kind of the top line of that, of the melody, what he's playing. And that's a great example too, to something to practice. You could, practice your chromatic scale. And here's a great, a different rhythmic device instead of, just a straight chromatic scale. You've got, put it against. You start to feel that push and pull a little bit. Cool. So I'm gonna wrap up in a second. This is as you can see, there's a bunch more stuff. Like I said, I'll leave this this PDF for everybody. There's a whole, there's this great Cachao solo that's really great on here, Oscar Hernandez. But it, there are a lot of questions coming in. And we'll see, maybe at the end, if we have time to listen to one more, we can drop that in. But it does, I was able to get through those main concepts. So hopefully that gives people something to listen for, as well as some things to think about, to start using when you're improvising or working on soloing, and practicing. And let me see. I think I can just drag and drop that PDF into the chat. Is that right? Does anybody? Shows how much I know.
Yeah, good question. Yeah, Greg was asking about that. Yeah, that'd be cool.
I'll figure it out, yeah. But let me scroll through these questions, because there's a lot of people had some good questions. So let me jump.
You can drag and drop the link if you got a link, that's all.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so Michael, going way back to the top, Michael's asking about playing in clave versus against clave. And that's something that, you know, with all this stuff, people kind of have slightly different, you know, definitions or ways they talk about it. But I've heard people talk about playing, like I mentioned at the beginning, like people will say something is crossed if it's like wrong, sort of, you know, like, so you're playing, you know, an example would be like, if I'm playing a melody, like, let's say, you know, like Picadillo by Tito Puente is a really clear one. It starts with that same piano rhythm. And it's, you know, when you listen to Tito play it, it's a really clear, really clearly phrased in 2-3. The phrase starts on the 2 side. So an example of like crossed would be if the rhythm section's playing 3-3-2 and the melody is obviously starting on the, you know, should be starting on the other side of the clave. So that's an example of cross. Now playing against the clave, it may be what you're thinking of is like on purpose or for effect. And I think that's something that happens, like a great example are these hemiolas or cross rhythms that we're looking at, because inevitably when you're playing with these hemiolas, if you keep that cross rhythm going for more than a couple bars, you're going to end up going against the grain of the clave. I mean, the clave kind of has a built-in hemiola on the 3 side already, but since the clave is a 2-bar pattern and the hemiola won't come back around for 3 bars, it's going to rub, but you're doing it on purpose, and if you know how to get out of it, that's kind of the important thing, is listening for how to get out of it. In that Celia and Tito example, I think I closed that. There's a pretty good example of that, where she sings this phrase that starts with a hemiola, and she carries it through for a few bars. Let's see, where did that go? Yeah, just this first one. She carries it through for a few bars, but it stops here, and it stops right smack on this accent with the clave here. So you get raka taka ta taka taka ta taka taka ta taka ta, and you know that second bar in the middle there, it feels a little like it's, you know, when you try to sing it with the clave, it doesn't feel super right, you know, but as a whole phrase, because it starts in and it resolves, you know, it's like it's a rhythmic resolution, is one way to do it. I've heard about people talking about playing like against the clave on, you know, on purpose for effect, which, you know, it's like playing, if you want to, for those of you who play melodic instruments or harmonic instruments, you know, like playing outside of the key or outside of the chords, you know, on purpose to create some kind of tension. But it's like a lot of stuff where, Sorry, I'm trying to do two things at once here. It's like a lot of things where it's like if you're doing it intentionally and you're still aware of like what's going on in the rhythm section, where the clave is at, where the phrase, you know, phrasing and the harmony is, it can be effective versus doing it as like a mistake, not knowing kind of where you are. So let's see, a lot of good stuff played against clave. Yeah, shaving a haircut. That's totally in 3-2 clave. Anyone know if Rebecca is still teaching at CCSF? I'm pretty sure she's not. I think it's been a while since Rebecca, some Daniel's asking about Rebecca Moleon. As far as I know, she's education director at SF Jazz, right? And has been for a while, doing a lot of cool stuff there. Let's see. And then, yeah, 12-8 or 6-8. Like 12, I think, and Trigger spoke to this in the chat a little bit. The 12-8 or 6-8, I mean, usually when we talk about it, we talk about it in 6-8, or if you see it written, it's in 6-8. But that's a whole, and I just decided, like, because I'd done a bunch of this work in 4-4, sort of, you know, and it's a very much related, and it's part of the genre, you know, and everything, but just kind of for time, didn't want to spend time going into 6-8 clave, but in a broad sense, it works kind of the same, you know, that 6-8 clave bell pattern. It has the way I was clapping it there. It has a more kind of downbeat oriented and a more upbeat oriented side. It has that same push and pull. So it's very much related. So if you get into the music, the playing in 6-8, of course, is very different because now there's, you know, the subdivisions are different. The feel is different. Let's see. What else is going on? About New Orleans music and the Bo Diddley rhythm, and that's totally all clave. I mean, it's the Bo Diddley rhythm, or the, you know, like hand jive or whatever, that you know, that kind of stuff. You hear like in some early rock and roll and things like that, and New Orleans music. As I'm not so much a historian, but I think, you know, it all kind of comes from the same place, because again, it's like, it's coming from, the African diaspora, you know, all this rhythm, you know, any rhythm, you know, any of the rhythmic stuff we're doing in American popular music has its basis, you know, in the African diaspora, just like, in Cuba and Brazil and all over Latin America and stuff. Of course, it gets blended and fused with different things depending on where it is, you know, so we end up with all these different unique traditions in all these different places, but there are a lot of these similarities, and sometimes the similarities are like surface level, and sometimes they're really kind of deep, you know, so you can hear that clave rhythm really clearly in, you know, and that kind of stuff. But there's all, you know, there are all kinds of deeper things, like a lot of jazz melodies that the composers weren't thinking about clave or necessarily, but they fit so well, so much in clave, things like that. Let's see, Craig's writing, Ned Sublette's book on music of Cuba is a very detailed about the history, which it is. That's a great book. Covers music from, he starts in West Africa, where the people came from in West Africa, and the traditions there. And he takes it up to about the 1950s, like the birth of the mambo, kind of, or the mambo craze. But it's a great book. So I want to leave a little bit of time here at the end, try to figure out, if I have to have a link to the file, we'll figure something out here to get you guys this stuff. But Any other questions that I missed and that anybody else has?
We could open it up to verbal questions too, maybe.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
We got time. I don't know if we got time, but we could have some, not just chat questions if y'all want.
I did also want to mention that Sylvia has been plugging some of our classes that we offer in our chat. So make sure you grab those. And then I'm going to put a couple more in there of the upcoming events that we have. Just to give you a quick run through, we have a virtual concert with conversation. And we also have, let me see, we have our spring gala. And I will be putting all of that information in the chat right now.
Cool. And also, just to let y'all know, I'm not ending this. I just wanted to let you know that in 2 weeks, we're going to have Miguel Gouveia, who was the leader of Los Compas for many years, and also the Gouveia Peña group, where it's a family group. Awesome, wonderful musician. He's talk about his musical journey. Well, I don't know exactly what he's going to talk about, but it's going to be coming from, you know, he's a Chicano, talking about his musical journey. He's a salsa musician. He's a wonderful trumpet player, a colleague of ours. He also plays Mexican music, has a great appreciation and a great, he's a wonderful interpreter. I mean, the guy is awesome. And also, Charlie, I wanted to ask you about, well, Charlie, I didn't know, we were talking a while ago, that we both went to the same high school. That was funny.
Yeah.
Went to Soda. Yeah, that's cool. And I just wanted to know, like, how your online jazz ensemble stuff is coming too.
Yeah. So yeah, I teach a couple of jazz ensembles, doing more, you know, straight ahead jazz kind of. I mean, we do all kinds of stuff, but like small jazz combos here at CMC. And the transition online's been kind of interesting, you know, like everybody else. And we've tried a few different things. We're doing a lot of transcription, you know, so like the stuff I've been sharing today, you know, I mean, we haven't been doing these kinds of transcriptions, but, you know, jazz solos. So we've been doing both in class kind of ear training, learning phrases, learning vocabulary. You know, I'm big on when you're learning a tradition, whether it's like Afro-Cuban music or, you know, or jazz or whatever. It's, you know, about learning stuff by ear, doing a lot of listening and really understanding the vocabulary of the music, you know, the rhythmic and melodic vocabulary. So we do a lot of that. We learn tunes, you know, like kind of what we've been doing in class, but since we can't play together, we share in our individual performances from home, you know, and get feedback, ask questions. And
it's been a real challenge for us teachers online with group ensembles. It's been a challenge, but I didn't want to stop the Clave discussion. So
totally.
Anybody has any questions about the, you know, what Charlie talked about? He brought up a lot of different points. If anybody has any more questions about Clave, we're still online, so please ask.
And I'm sorry, I'm trying to get this these files shared, but I am being stumped by technology.
is there a way that Sylvia or Chantel, we don't have a is there a way we can send emails to people with the links later that are here? We can. Okay. So Charlie, don't worry about it.
Awesome. Yeah.
We will send the links. Everybody who registered for tonight through Eventbrite, we will get you those links.
But recording it too. I missed the first 10 minutes, which was probably pretty important. So if there's a chance to see the recording, that would be awesome. If you're sending out links. And it's,
yeah, how does that work, Sylvia or Chantel?
I'm not sure. We'll talk with Charlie about that, but I know we'll be sharing the recording at some point, but I know we can definitely share the links for the moment.
Okay, we'll try to share the recording with everybody who has participated. So if you want to check out something else again, we'll get that out to you at some point, hopefully. Yeah, I think it'll happen though.
Right on. Well, unless there's anything else, that went by quick. Could have been here all night.
No Clave questions, please.
Yeah, I mean, like,
Shirley, come on, Shirley.
Lindo's got a great question. Is that, you know, is there going to be a part two? maybe, you know, we can talk about offering a class or a workshop. I actually tried, I tried to offer a workshop one summer around this, but, you know, sometimes those things don't fill up, or that was, you know, a few years ago or whatever. So we could think about that. But Luna's got a great question about taking a melodic line and figuring out how it fits in clave, which is like, you know, I mentioned a lot of jazz, a lot of, you know, American jazz or, you know, from the United States actually fits really well in clave, even though the composers weren't thinking in clave. And that's like, it's like a game a lot of jazz music or a lot of Latin jazz musicians like to play, is to kind of like take tunes and go, hey, does this fit in clave? Or like, or do, you know, first, does it feel like it's on the two side or on the three side? And is there anything we have to tweak, you know, where we would have to tweak to like make it rhythmically fit? And a lot of times there isn't, you know, there's a lot of stuff that just sits right in there, you know, feels great playing it in clave. But yeah, I'd love to do more of it. So yeah, maybe another video presentation, maybe when we're in person, you know, do some sooner than later, hopefully.
And sorry, Charlie, to do a little self-promotion, but I also teach a class on Wednesdays at 5:30.
That's right.
That's open for musicians. You have to have a certain level of proficiency on some instrument, where I talk a lot. It's called Cuban Fundamentals. And it, so talk a lot about clave there. You can check that out. Sorry to jump in on your
that's totally
presentation, but
am I muted or am I unmuted?
You are unmuted, Shirley.
Oh, okay. Here's the thing. I'm a babe in this, as you know. What I want to know is how to put clave onto a very popular tune.
It depends on Charlie, sorry.
Oh, no, yeah. It totally depends on the tune. And it's kind of like, you need to think of it from the other way around, if that makes sense. Like, if you have a, you need to develop a sense first of how clave works. Mm-hmm. And then when you're listening to like a popular tune or whatever you're working with, you'll be able to get a sense of how it fits, you know, in clave, how it might fit in clave. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's easier said than done, for sure. But people do it all the time. It's definitely possible. Yeah. Cool. Well, actually, I would love to talk more, but I think in 10 minutes I have to I got a class to teach. So thank you for coming.
Thank you so much, Charlie, for the presentation. That was great, and thank you everybody for coming. Great to see everybody. See you, Shirley. Well, yeah, a lot of people, Catherine, you know, Luna. Oh, I can keep going, but thank you all for coming. That's great. And thank you, Charlie, for such a great presentation.
Thank you, Charlie. That was great.
Your knowledge with it. It was super.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Thank you,
Charlie.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone. I hope to see you.
Thank you.
Bye.
My mom, too.
Bye.